This is a continuation of the last video that we were working on. I think I have like 5 more examples. Here we're supposed to factor, we're still factoring, or 6 more examples maybe. We're supposed to factor, so again, when we factor, I'm gonna go ahead and for number 20, I'm gonna use u substitution. This is an expression that's in quadratic form. If you remember, quadratic form is where we have the same function, right? The same thing here, but this exponent is double this one. Okay, so I'm gonna do u substitution and set this equal to cotangent squared. So I get u squared plus 3u plus 2. So I know that factors of 2 that add to 3 are 2 and 1. So I get u plus 2. U plus 1. I'm going to go ahead and substitute cotangent squared back in there and see if there's any more factoring that I can do. Well, this one I believe is complete. This one is also complete because the sum of squares is prime. So this is how this expression factors. All right, I'm going to do the same thing here. I am going to set u. Oh, wait a second. I'm going to set a equal to sine of alpha, and this is an alpha, and b equal to cosine of alpha to help us out a little bit. So this is going to be a cubed plus b cubed, which is back in chapter 5, one of our factoring formulas. And that factors exactly into a plus b, a squared minus ab plus b squared. So now I'm just going to go ahead and do a direct substitution in, and you can see I have sine of alpha plus cosine of alpha times sine of alpha squared minus, sine of alpha. I don't think I've given myself enough space to write this all in. Cosine of alpha plus cosine squared of alpha. Okay, so that is sine cubed alpha plus cosine cubed alpha in factored form. So now we're moving on to our verifications. I'm gonna show, oh no, we're not moving on to our verifications. We're gonna express, we're going to simplify each of these expressions, and they should simplify either to a constant, a single function, or a power of a single function. So again, this is, we're just going to manipulate, use some of our hints, manipulate our identities or use some of our hints. And the first hint that I'm going to use is to write everything in terms of sine and cosine, because I don't know how tangent and cosine actually relate to each other. So I'm gonna write tangent in terms of sine over cosine. And now I have times cosine. So here you can clearly see that the cosines reduce out and I get just sine. All right, so what am I gonna do here? So I know cosecant squared and 1 are in one of my identities, my Pythagorean identities. So what is that identity? I know it's 1 plus cotangent squared theta equals cosecant squared of theta. And maybe I can manipulate this to figure out if I can get cosecant squared minus 1. Which I can by subtracting 1 from both sides. So an equivalent alternative identity is cotangent squared equals cosecant squared minus 1. So I can replace cosecant squared minus 1 with cotangent squared. So here we don't have theta, and I forgot my theta here. Don't forget your theta. We have t instead. So this is going to be cotangent squared of t. All right, so this is one function raised to a power, so that satisfies my given constraints. All right, and so how about this one? Well, I think what I would do here is I would start off by writing cosecant of x in terms of its reciprocal function, in terms of sine and cosine. So I get sine of x over sine squared of x over cosine squared x plus sine of x, and then cosecant is 1 over sine of x. Remember, these two functions are reciprocal, so when I multiply them, I should get a 1, which makes it really convenient. Sine squared x over cosine squared x, that's going to reduce to a 1. And I know that tangent squared, sine squared x over cosine squared x equals tangent squared x, and that looks like one of my Pythagorean identities. So I know that tangent squared plus 1 is secant squared. So this simplifies down into secant squared of x, which is one trigonometric function raised to a power. All right, so let's go ahead and do this one. Okay, so I know that the reciprocal of secant is cosine. So I'm going to start off by just flipping this, you know, taking the reciprocal, using my reciprocal function. And I get this. Well, that looks a lot like one of the alternative forms of sine squared plus cosine squared equals 1. Because if I subtract cosine squared, I get 1 minus cosine squared x. So I know that 1 minus cosine squared x is just sine squared x. And that satisfies the constraints my instructions gave me. All right, so this next section is all about verifying trigonometric identities. So I will only ever work on one side. So one of the hints that they suggested is that you take the more complicated side and you use algebraic techniques along with your trigonometric identities to reduce it to the more simplistic side. All right, so the very first thing I'm going to do is identify the side that I'm going to work on. So I look at this, and this looks way more complicated than this does. So I'm going to change the left side and hopefully get it to look like the right side. So I think what I'm going to do is use one of their hints where it says change everything to sine and cosine. So tangent is the sine of alpha over the cosine of alpha, and secant is 1 over the cosine of alpha. So I'm not going to do anything to the right hand side, but I do know that when I divide by a fraction, it's like multiplying by its reciprocal. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to multiply by the reciprocal of this denominator here. And you can see that the cosines will reduce out. So I end up with the sine of alpha, which is exactly what I wanted to have here. And this is how I end my proof, right? I don't need to write sine of alpha all the way down. I can just draw a nice arrow to the sine of alpha equals the sine of alpha. And there we have our first trigonometric proof. So we're going to do the same thing to the other three examples that I have here. So again, I notice that my more complicated side is the left-hand side. That's not always true. So I'm going to take a look at this left-hand side, and I notice that I can distribute sine squared of beta. So let's go ahead and distribute that across the binomial here. So I get sine squared of beta plus sine squared of beta times the cotangent squared of beta. All right, so I really don't know what to do next, so I'm just going to jump straight to rewriting everything in terms of sine and cosine. That's an awesome thing to do. If you get stuck. So cotangent is cosine squared over sine squared. And now you can clearly see that our sine squareds are going to simplify out. So I end up with the sine squared of beta plus cosine squared of beta. And I know that this expression is one of my Pythagorean identities. It equals one. So I have just completed my proof. Yay! Nicely done, Mrs. Peterson. Okay, here's another example. How do we verify this? Which side is more complicated? Well, I don't really know which side is more complicated. Okay, so what I can do though is I can just pick a side. I mean, they both look kind of complicated. So I'm just going to pick this side. And I notice that I'm going to work the left side, but I notice on the right-hand side I have a subtraction here. So somehow I'm going to have two things being subtracted, or else I'm not going to be able to change the left side to the right side. So one of my Pythagorean identities is sine squared plus cosine squared equals one. If I solve for sine squared in that identity, I get one minus cosine squared theta. So I can replace sine squared theta with one minus cosine squared theta. And I know I can split this fraction into two separate fractions. One over the cosine of theta minus cosine squared theta over cosine of theta. And now when I replace, this is one of my reciprocal identities. I know that 1 over cosine is equivalent to secant of theta. And now I can reduce this fraction. One of my cosines reduces out. And you can see I have just changed the left side to look exactly like the right side here. I'm going to go ahead and write this down. All right, so you know what I'm going to do here? I am going to go ahead and erase my work, and I'm going to work on the right-hand side instead and show you that this example can be done both ways. All right, so let's see if I can get this erased so that we have enough time in our video to do this. Okay, so now I'm going to start on this side. So I think what I want to do first is, because I really don't know what to do, I'm just going to convert everything to sine and cosine. So secant is 1 over cosine of theta. And now I notice there really isn't too much to do besides the actual subtraction, right? So I'm going to find a common denominator, which will be cosine, and I'm going to rewrite this over here using my common denominator. So I need to multiply cosine of theta by cosine of theta over cosine of theta. So now I have cosine squared theta over cosine of theta. And I can combine this into one fraction because now I have a nice common denominator. And I can see that I already have the denominator set. And I know that this is one of those alternative equivalent forms of one of my Pythagorean identities. And that reduces to sine squared of theta over cosine of theta. So now we have the same thing on both sides. We have gone through our verification process and it all works out. So I've got one more example. It's going to be on another video. It's going to be this one. If you feel like taking a look at this one, go ahead and continue watching the next video.